live. James, how are you doing? Are you all right?
Very well, thanks, Will. How
you
are
look
you?
A bit terrified. Hey, I'm a nice guy. You don't have to be terrified by me. I'm okay. I'm one of the nice ones.
You're one of the nice guys.
Yeah, I pride myself on at least being somewhat nice to the people I like. But of which you are one.
Oh, thank you.
Don't worry.
Mate. Thanks for having me.
Hey, right, mate, it's my pleasure. And what is also my pleasure was Noisily last year.
Wow, that's good to hear.
I think it's possibly one of my favourite festivals to play.
Oh, wow. That's
along
good to
with
hear.
Secret Garden, which sadly, RIP.
RIP.
Yeah, I know. Terrifying.
Oh, that's good to hear. Thanks.
Yeah, no, it was great. I think a festival is a little bit like it's a little bit like the end of the world in a way, because you've got a sort of you have everybody camping, but also trying to having a great time, and it's a little bit sort of self-contained, like it's like your own little world for a few days.
Yeah, and a bit of escape from the norm.
Yeah, and when you've got like really good sun and everything gets dusty, it can get a little bit post-apocalyptic.
It certainly can.
Maybe that's just Boomtown, I don't know.
Especially when you don't sleep much.
Yeah, exactly. And you kind of form weird bonds with people that some people you can, you know, become friends with for life. Other people you really think you're going to, and then you never see them ever again.
Exactly.
Or you see them the following year at the same festival, or never again. But yeah, it's like a sort of weird little microcosm of society.
Yeah.
Which I think is one of the best things, you know, about festivals.
Yeah, definitely. People can like let loose and be who they want to be who they are.
Yeah. And I've been to a few where I've kind of not really let loose, and that's definitely massively impacted on the level of enjoyment that I've had.
That's
like, because you sort of like, if you're trying to be too cool about it, and you're like, no, I'm not going to dress up, I'm not going to wear any silly outfits or paint my face or anything. And then you sort of go and wish, oh, I should have just got stuck in. And then the next time, I'm like, right, I'm going to get stuck in, right, get the face paints on, you know, I'm going to wear some stupid leggings and a ridiculous outfit. I had the absolute time of my life. That's what it's all about.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let me just try and share this little number on everything. It will all be fine. So tell me about how you got started in music in general.
Music in general, from a young age I was into the guitar.
Mm-hmm.
I've always been into music and collecting music and buying music from a young age.
Yep.
Large vinyl collection that I still got, like we were talking about earlier.
Yeah.
And kind of just through the passion of music, really.
Mm-hmm.
And ended up going off to uni and met a guy called Ross, who I started putting on outdoor raves with in Kent.
Right.
Which
legally or illegally?
Illegally.
Nice. Very nice.
And they blew up quite quick. Liquid Connective Parties.
What year was that in?
From 1998.
Okay, so we're going full old school. We're going
old school, yeah.
Having to ring from a phone box.
Phone numbers and messages and that kind of stuff.
Changing the answer phone messages to
exactly.
Did you have like a series of different
like decoys? All that kind of stuff.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh God. How big was your first one that you did?
Oh, the first one was really just close friends, so like maybe 100 or something like that, but they very quickly became a couple of thousand people.
Really?
Within a couple of years, yeah.
With like multiple sound systems?
Yeah,
or
mainly two sound systems, so like the main dance area and a sort of chill out kind of area.
Mm-hmm. What sort of music?
All electronic, but the main dance areas were like psytrance, really.
Right.
And the chill outs were everything else, eclectic kind of stuff.
Right. Did you get into trouble?
No, we didn't ever get into trouble, actually.
Really?
No, because we managed them quite well.
Okay.
And tidied up after ourselves stayed one step ahead of them, basically.
Whereabouts were they?
They were mostly all in Kent.
Right, okay. Mm. So did you go out scouting for...
Yeah, scouting for good locations and all that kind of stuff.
That sounds exciting.
It was really exciting. Yeah. It was a really good time, actually. And from that came Liquid Records and the stage... the Glade Festival, the Liquid Stage.
Right, okay.
So that was an evolution of that, really.
Okay.
Which was, yeah, so...
Glade was... are they still doing Glades? Or
Glade stopped a while ago now.
Glade was also a early noughties Glade festivals, like, or mid-noughties, really. Like, I think 2006 I went and really
2004 was the first one.
Was it? Okay. Yeah.
But yeah, amazing festivals. Like Brilliant. Secret Garden, when they both started up, they both had magic and really good intentions. I think they both probably got a bit too big too quick.
Yeah, it's a tricky one, isn't it? Because, I mean, I'm sure you know better than most how to sort of... It's hard enough to make money out of a festival at the best of times.
Yeah.
And then there's obviously a temptation to try and ramp things up.
Yeah, it's difficult, that fine line of keeping integrity.
Yes.
And making it work as a business model and, you know.
That's just the music industry in general, isn't it? Trying to maintain your creative integrity with making music and then also pay your bills.
Exactly. So it's a fine line to sort of tread, really. So
yeah.
It's difficult.
Yeah, I do think that festivals have certainly one of the toughest jobs in the...
Oh, absolutely, because there's a lot of hoops you have to jump through.
Yeah.
You know, going back from doing those outdoor parties to what I'm doing now, it's a whole different ball game, you know?
Well, you've actually got rules to play.
actually have to speak to the police and the councils and all of that kind of stuff. And there's a lot of bureaucracy that in England, especially, that you have to... adhere to, which is kind of a good thing, but it's also sometimes goes a bit too far.
Yeah, well, you like to hope that it's all comes from good intentions of you know, the police and the government and the man wanting people to be safe and enjoy themselves but have good safe fun.
Yeah, exactly.
Or rather than just keep the man down.
Yeah, but going back to Glade and Secret Garden, they were amazing festivals, you know.
Yeah.
It's a shame that they're no longer here, but we're trying to sort of feel, I think Noisely is a bit of an amalgamation of those two sort of vibes.
Yeah, I would definitely say so. Like remembering early Secret Garden parties and just the amount of effort they put in to the decor and the sort of, I remember Eddie Temple Morris saying to me that they spent more money per head on people than any other festival.
Right,
like on sort of providing...
on the sort of attention to details.
And you could really see it.
Yeah, definitely. That's special moments. That's what we're doing with Noisely as well, the attention to detail.
Yeah, that's one of the things that really shot out to me when I went there was like, well, A, it's magical because it's all in the forest, which is great.
Yeah.
How does that work in the rain? It was very nice when I was there.
Well, it's got very good drainage and stuff, so it's never gonna get like a Glastonbury when you're like up to your thighs in mud sort of thing. But it's obviously it's much nicer at a festival when it's sunny.
Yeah.
But we've been lucky with the weather most years. We've had quite a bit of rain on, say, one day.
Yeah.
And we've had to close off little tiny sections of the site that are maybe too steep to walk up, but none of the arenas have ever been shut down, and it's still all accessible. And
canoes required, or anything like that.
No,
Lilo's.
No, just
get the mud wrestling
just
started.
Just your Meggins and your face paints and all that.
Yeah, I think I'm going to be sporting Meggins at all my festival appearances this year. It's the only way. I mean, I actually probably wear Meggins more than most people because I wear them at jiu-jitsu every time I train. And so even if I'm wearing, you know, my grappling gear, I've always got them on underneath.
Yeah, I'm sure you can pull it off quite well.
You know, I've got a fantastic set of pins, even for a man my size.
I can see that.
I've seen you iron them up. Jealous of the pins. Right, so illegal raves in Kent in the late 90s. I bet there's some stories.
Yeah, there are some stories that, you know.
Yeah, probably best not to tell publicly.
Probably best not to talk about that. But it was a sort of a golden era of outdoor parties then.
Yeah. Defining moment for UK dance culture,
really.
It definitely did.
And, you know, in many ways, we were sort of a bit later on in that. We were like late 90s.
Yeah.
But it was still a really amazing time and really just came from a place of good intention, wanting to put on a good event, sharing music, bringing our friends together.
Yeah.
And that alone just exploded.
Mm.
We never thought we were going to be putting on huge events with thousands of people at them.
Yeah.
And, you know, but that's what happened. So we had to sort of move with it and sort of step it up, stop doing them.
Yeah.
And, you know, set the label up and do club nights. And then Glade started, and a lot of the original directors obviously knew us and were at those parties and got in touch with us and said, look, they were quite a bit better at business at the time than we were.
Yeah, yeah.
And they said, look, we're going to do this. Do you want to be a part of it and have a stage there? And it was a way that we could carry on doing what we were doing, which,
yeah,
and keep Liquid in the public domain. And
well, that's always a good way of doing stuff. It's like, well, hey, we're great at putting on really great things, but you know, and you guys are good at organizing the business side of things.
Exactly, yeah.
Let's have a little partnership.
Yeah, it takes a long time as a creative person to get your head around,
yeah,
the sort of business side of stuff and all of that.
Yeah, it's very difficult to be good at everything, like,
yeah.
And a lot of the time, particularly for being an artist or a promoter or, you know, a lot of stuff to do with the music industry, like, I don't think people are designed to have all the skills in all the necessary areas.
No.
Like, if you're very, very creative, you are quite often lower in conscientiousness,
yeah,
and you're not very organized.
Sure.
And
not very good at spreadsheets and stuff.
Not
like
very
that.
Good at spreadsheets and not very good at getting stuff in on time.
Exactly.
Or remembering things. Or doing your accounts on time, that,
yeah,
sort of thing.
Exactly,
so
yeah.
If you can find someone, you know, a little bit more conservative to do all that stuff,
yeah,
for you,
well,
you've got a great partnership.
Everyone's got their strengths, haven't they? So
exactly.
You know, that's one amazing thing with Noisely, is that a really solid team has formed,
mm-hmm,
and we're all aware of each other's strengths and weaknesses, and you work with them, you know?
Yeah.
And between us, we're getting it done.
Yeah, excellent.
Yeah.
So what were the festivals that, apart from Glade, obviously, and Secret Garden, what legitimate festivals did you ones you had to buy a ticket for?
Well,
that you went to.
My first festival that I went to was Glastonbury.
Right.
I think it was 95. So, mm-hmm, Left Field, the year Left Field album came out. Left,
nice.
I didn't pay for a ticket. It was one of those skirmishing through fields, and a part of the adventure back then. You obviously can't do that now.
I mean, it would take some sort of ninja to get in there now. It's hard enough to get in when you've actually got a ticket.
Yeah.
Or I've only been to Glastonbury once, and I have to say it's probably one of my worst festival experiences.
Really?
I mean, it was the actual DJing side of it. Once I got through the gate, it took 6 hours to get to the stage that I was playing on. And
yeah.
I was almost late, despite arriving at the festival 6 hours before having to play.
Oh, really?
And then the place where I had to park versus the stage that I had to play at were total opposite ends. Mm. And it was pouring with rain, and it was knee deep mud, and I had a bag of 200 records on me. And it was just absolutely brutal. It was like one of those TV shows where they make people do like SAS training or something. Mm. And then my prize was to play drum and bass for a couple of hours on an outdoor stage while it was pouring with rain. But like, it was completely empty when I started playing. But then by the time I finished, there was a couple of thousand people there. So it was worth every second of being up to my waist.
Quite
an
overwhelming festival, though, isn't it? A lot of people.
I mean, it's just a whole nother
thing. It is, really,
thing. Yeah.
So that was my first festival. And it obviously blew my mind at the time.
Mm.
It was... and funnily enough, that was the first time I saw Left Field, which was the year their album came out. And I saw them... the Arcadia 10-year anniversary a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, yeah.
And they headlined the Saturday night.
Really?
So I hadn't seen them since then, and it was really good to see them again, and they'd remixed all the work and remastered it, and Arcadia obviously is amazing.
They've
production.
Put on a hell of a show, don't
wow.
they? Yeah, yeah.
It's incredible,
it's quite something.
It is, yeah.
getting up to that booth is ridiculous. I remember Alan Hostage telling me some story of him playing on one of the Arcadia things where like you're up on a tiny little tower and you've like held up with stuff and all the power going off and him just being there in the dark at the top not knowing what to do.
Definitely one
that's
of the best,
terrifying.
One of the best productions in the world, I think, at the moment, for sure.
Do they do the things with the guys fighting with the electricity?
Yeah, they do.
I've never seen anything like that before. That is one of the most spectacular
with,
things
like,
I've ever seen.
50-foot flames. And it's just bonkers. It's a whole sort of choreographed theatrical AV. It's just incredible. It's
Can you imagine getting in one of those suits? Like, so for anyone that hasn't seen it, it's... basically, it's two guys stood in these... suits that are conducting electricity, and they're basically like the Tesla coils from Red Alert, and they're just sort of fighting with electricity that's going through the suits and going through the air, and I wouldn't fancy putting one of them on. It just seems like, I mean, you really are asking for trouble, aren't you?
I think so.
I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to basically wrap myself in cables and tinfoil and conduct electricity to myself. You imagine your mum just looking at that. No.
It looks amazing though, doesn't it?
Yeah. It's rather them than me, though.
Mm.
So, yeah, that Arcadia really, a couple of weeks ago, yeah. I couldn't make it, but I did feel a bit sad that I wasn't there.
Yeah, it was amazing.
Yeah.
Good, yeah. And I think then they had the drum and bass on the Sunday.
Yes.
Yeah, but we went on the Saturday, so.
Get that mic.
Oh, sorry.
That's right. I mean, take it with you if you want to make it around. That's fine, yeah. Yeah, take it home, I don't care. So post first Glastonbury, what, any smaller ones?
No, I went to some of the sort of like smaller hippie festivals, like Big Green Gathering and...
Oh, yeah.
What was the one that the Big Chill?
Big Chill was a popular one, but
all of that kind of stuff. A few of the WOMADs and all that kind of stuff. I've experienced a few.
The more middle classy ones.
Oh yeah, but I wasn't so.
No, we're gonna go to Reading and set fire to the toilets and see Limp Bizkit.
I haven't been to any of those ones, but I've been to a few Glastonbury's playing.
Yeah.
I've never been as a punter, but I've had a few Glastonbury experiences.
Yeah, yeah.
All of the Glades, because I was involved with that, and Secret Garden actually as a punter for the first for the first few was incredible.
Yeah,
like really, really beautiful festival.
Yeah, around that lake, when the sun comes out, that's and that it. Pagoda thing that they've got, that's the magic.
And
right
I think
there.
Last year was the last one, wasn't it?
Yeah, I hear rumours about them starting doing some little private thingies, and we will see.
We'll see.
I hope so. I mean, lovely thing.
Mm.
So, what were some of the favourite acts of, apart from Left Field, from early days of festival going?
Oh, mate. That's a hard one.
Seeing people at festivals on big stages is so different from seeing people in clubs, for DJs and stuff.
Yeah. I mean, early Glades and stuff, people like Noisia when they were just starting and... Pendulum even, in their early days.
Yeah.
Some incredible live shows, I mean, so many, it's hard to say.
Yeah, I remember seeing Tim Exile in the Little Big Tent at Glade, 2006.
The Little Big Tent, yeah.
Mad, just one of the most amazing live shows I've ever seen with him, just like live looping, his voice, shouting stuff, looping it back, mashing out with amens and stuff, dropping original Nutter over it, and just like, I've just blown away. And then Cassette Boy, I think, after them or something, just leaping around in silly outfits.
Yeah, it was bonkers that stage, the Little Big Tent, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was
very experimental, sort of.
Yeah, it's very experimental. And all the wrong music.
I saw Square Pusher there as well at Glade. That was definitely Twist Your Melons a bit, that one.
Yeah, I saw Aphex Twin as well, and he, for about the first half an hour of his set, was just swear words with like a load of echo on them. Like, I think he was just sort of seeing how long he could get away with it for.
Yeah.
And then it sort of got crazy after that. There was some Aphex
magic. I've never seen Aphex Twin, actually. Like, yeah. I've never
you hear
seen
a lot of sort of rumours and myths about him at
he's
festivals.
Gonna be,
He was there in a deck chair just watching it and drinking, throwing cans at the stage. I'm not sure whether or not any of this really happened. But it's true that there are rumours.
Yeah.
So Noisily started 2012?
Yeah, it started in 2012, that's right, yeah.
Yeah, and how big was the first one? Has it been in the same place the whole time?
It's basically was, there's five directors, there's four co-founders, so I joined in for year three.
Right.
This will be year seven, and it's always been in the same site, so it's one of the directors, it's the land and the estate has been in his family for a fair few hundred years, basically. So it's
right.
Beautiful
lots
old English country estate.
Yeah, yeah.
And we're very fortunate enough that the family let them have the party on the land. So, and it's, as you know, you've been there. It's such a beautiful site.
Yeah.
And we're basically just in a tiny pocket of the estate that's a kind of forest valley sort of.
Right.
Bit with clearings where we've got the stages and whatnot.
Yeah, yeah.
So, started in 2012 and this will be year seven.
Yeah.
And we'll probably have 4,000 ticket buyers this year.
Nice.
And we've always just grown organically, so there's no sponsorship.
Mm-hmm.
It's all been done by us, built from the ground up kind of thing, and we're never going to go bigger than maybe 5,000-6,000 people.
Yeah.
So we create that sort of boutique, intimate, good vibes.
There is a different vibe to the smaller festival than there is to the monster festivals.
Yeah.
It's because by the end of a weekend, you sort of it's not like you know everyone there, but like you're recognizing the same people come and go all the time, and you know, it becomes like a I don't know, a little kibbutz or something. Being able to share each other's children around. You know, hey, you raise my kids for a couple of years, I'll raise yours. You know, why not?
It's 18 plus, Noisley. No kids allowed.
Oh, yeah.
It's just for adults. Yeah.
Smart.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's not a license insurance. That's not a license or an insurance thing. Right. That's just we think that it's an 18 plus.
You see people at Glastonbury in the mud pushing prams around and just like...
I've got
people at Boomtown with kids.
Yeah, I've got two kids. I just don't think it's the right place. I mean, you've got a year to get some babysitting in, you know, babysitters. Yeah. Enjoy yourself, go out and have fun.
Yeah.
One weekend a year or whatever.
Yeah, you just sort of see the kind of hippie tearaways with the kids, just like, no one's got any shoes on. So everyone's covered in mud. I don't know. The kid's called like Moon Fairy or something. He's already got dreads. He's only 6 months old.
That's it.
Yeah, it's... I wouldn't fancy it. No pets, no kids.
That's it, yeah. Same, yeah. There's no pets, no kids.
Yeah. I don't know.
There's a lot of big kids.
Yeah, I'm one of them.
Same.
Desperately trying to behave.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, maybe not. How big was the first one? How many people?
The first one, probably a few hundred people.
Right.
So quite sort of intimate. Or not private, but, you know, quite...
Were you at the first one?
They booked me as Atomic Drop to play, so that's how I got to know the guys.
Okay.
I'd met them before then, and they're all sort of old friends. A couple of them are at uni together. I think initially the idea of them all doing an event actually happened on a dance floor at Glade Festival. That sort of, why don't we do this? And then the other two directors were friends at uni, so they just sort of came together and...
What were their experiences like? Did they have a background in event production?
I think a little bit, not lots, but I think a little bit through. I think Robbie, one of the guys, ran bars, and so the guys had sound systems and had done events up at uni in Leeds, and between them, a bit of knowledge, I guess a lot of passion and enthusiasm and
slot it all together, hope for the best.
Well, I played there as an artist for the first 2 years, and I got involved after that.
Great.
Basically, yeah.
Yeah. Mm. So, how many people were at the first one that you did? The first one that you were on the directors for?
I'm not sure. It went up to it went up a bit, like.
Sort of 500, 1,000.
No,
probably.
No, 1,500 or sort of 1,000. Yeah, I can't remember that. Looking at the spreadsheets, well,
yeah. Why haven't you ingested knowledge and stored it in your RAM at the front, ready to come straight out? Third, it was 772, and one dog that we had to throw out.
Yeah, I think there was actually, but it definitely grew and. We brought the Liquid Stage, to the festival, and I think that helped with bringing in that scene a bit as well.
Yeah.
And it's just growing from strength to strength, really, and it's a cracking team. Everyone works really hard.
So what are some of the things that I don't know, people might not think about, that you have to take into consideration when you've got 1,500 people coming together in some woods
and the rest? Well, don't fall, like fencing off the ditches and people's well-being basically. And when you're mixing everything, what people do mix at festivals in a forest in a valley, you have to just minimize all the risks basically, don't you? And
I guess it's a little bit like when you have to toddler proof a house.
Yeah,
you sort of have to take off all the sharp edges,
stair gate, put little things on the corners,
stuff in the plug socket so exactly. People don't put their fingers in. So you've got to have, you know, your security and so on. Do you have to have a specific amount of security per number of people?
Yeah, you do, yeah, and toilets and everything. Right. So we always...
Do you have those stats off the top of your head?
Not off the top of my head, Will, no. Yeah. I think it's something like one toilet per 50.
Right.
That has to be regularly serviced, obviously.
Seems reasonable.
And security, I, off the top of my head, no. But it's a big cost. It's a huge team. And
what's the biggest?
Have like traffic management, security. Yeah. There's a whole different aspects of it.
Is that one of the biggest expenses?
The security is a large expense, definitely.
Yeah.
But there are lots of, you know, just the fencing.
Yeah.
All the infrastructure, and it all adds up to a lot. Without the creative, without the artist, and we had to be, you know, we're working on very tight budgets with all of that, so the creative side of things.
Yeah, yeah. So something that I know lots of people listening to this will want to know is who are artists is there... Like, how do you decide who you're going to book? How can people, you know, go about trying to make themselves look good for bookings at festivals?
To get booked at the festival, yeah.
Not necessarily, but just in festivals in general.
In general.
And what do you look for when you're choosing lineups?
Well, what music that I like, what music's fresh, up and comers, especially with Noisy, because we're on small, we've got fairly tight budgets that have to look at who's about to blow up and just try and get them before they do go too big. Like we booked Matador quite a few years ago, and like to book him now would be probably nearly half of our whole techno stage budget, you know, but back then it was manageable.
Yeah.
My advice would be if you want to get booked at festivals, for example, next year, submit your demos almost now.
Right, yeah, yeah.
Like soon, because I mean, I do start working on all the bookings usually by August, September. This year, we're going to start doing it almost now.
Yeah, yeah.
So if you've got a sort of a year ahead plan, basically, and, you know, just be persistent, but without bombarding bookers and promoters, you know, just keep yourself in their sort of on their radar. Send them tracks, mixes, and you know, but well in advance.
I guess I think with a lot of these things, you know, who you know is important. If you can find ways of networking, you know, going to festivals, trying to talk to people, that sort of thing.
Exactly, yeah, there's a lot of that. And for me personally, with Noisely, I've obviously, like, you know, yourself included, you know, had to pull in and ask a lot of favours and for people to do things for mates rates and stuff, because from the outside it looks amazing, but actually the reality is there isn't that much to go around to make a thing like that work.
Well, a lot of people seem to be labouring under the misapprehension that festival bookings are, you get lots of money for festival bookings. No, you don't.
No.
It's festival bookings are some of the most enjoyable to play.
That's it.
They look great.
They look great, yeah.
For your, you know, your CV as such.
Yeah.
And your social media. And
your profile. And
great people there.
Yeah.
You meet a lot of other artists. You meet the people who are putting it on.
Yeah.
You will meet managers of other artists, agents of other artists.
Exactly.
People doing super cool stuff. Like, you know, half the... as an artist, half the fun of the festival is the sort of little back parties that are going on backstage.
Yeah, the little cliquey bit.
Yeah, away from the great unwashed, do you understand? And they're, you know, great for all of that side of stuff.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you can...
Lots of things will come from it.
Yeah.
Like you're talking about the networking and stuff. You've got to put the time into that.
Yeah.
You know.
And it's, you know, these things happen once a year and, you know, there's only so many slots, so...
Exactly.
You know, getting yourself in is...
I think at Noisely, we've got three main dance stages and, you know, the sets are, what, an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours each. There's only about 25 slots per stage for the whole weekend. So there's not that many.
Yeah.
You know, so we aim to have, obviously, a certain amount of acts that will appeal both to the sort of underground and, you know, press and stuff like that, and also leave a certain amount for up-and-coming artists and DJs, so that platform's there to sort of to help people and push people in that direction and stuff.
Well, ideally, everyone sort of pushes each other at the same time because, you know, if you get people on a nice upswing and they're shouting about playing with you and everything, then it all sort of, you know, feeds into itself.
Yeah, exactly.
Sorry, I'm getting really lost in my notes.
That's all right.
So, when you first started, did you have like a probably not like what is now a big thing is the sort of glamping.
Yeah.
Which that seems so last
you
5 years.
That.
Come on. I'll have a bit of clown poo. Also, I'm 6'4". I don't fit in most tents.
Yes. Like,
you know, find me one with an airbed and, you know, a fan in there.
Yeah, happy bunny then.
Yeah. I mean, your ideal sort of rig is your camp, is your decent sized camper van, like a big but really you want a big sort of Breaking Bad style, you know, meth lab on wheels.
That'd be awesome.
That's the dream. You know, perhaps without the meth
without the meth side of it.
But you know, where you can have a shower and all of that sort of thing.
Yeah, we've always had hot showers at Noisley. Glamping is in the early days there wasn't, but the thing from year three we actually built a few sort of like almost like houses on stilts.
Okay, yeah,
which was a huge amount of, it was a great idea, and we rented them out. There was only like six of them, but we had to take them down because a lot of the things at Noisley, the structures we build from scratch, they have to be taken down afterwards because the land's used for different things throughout the year.
What else do they get used for?
Well, they have pheasant shoots and so the fields where we're camping have cattle and stuff.
Right.
Not during the festival and that.
Really getting back to nature.
So yeah, you know, it's the land's used for other things throughout the year. So we built these big houses on stilts, basically, which paid for themselves and gave us loads of wood to use for building stages for the following year. But now we're getting companies that do bell tents and yurts and separate thing. It's not our sort of side company. It's a separate company that come in and provide all of those like memory foam beds and cotton sheets and moisturizer. You know, there's bronze, silver, gold thing.
Yeah.
So yeah, there's all of that now because the festival's grown to that size where and it's to order. So you just order it through the website.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it seems like a thing that people are kind of really seeing how far they can go with it. It's like, right, well, how posh can we make camping? Yeah. Like to the point of just, well, I've just built you a house. Like,
and then they're not even in it all weekend.
You're only in it for a couple of hours.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and it gets too hot in the morning and then you've just got to roll yourself back out again. I mean, this is always the thing. Like, again, with festivals, one of the sort of interesting things is how a lot of the party is actually after the music has finished.
After the license agreement stops.
And you go back to the campsite and then you have that, you know, sort of full insanity of everybody just milling around and going into each other's tents and setting up these little groups and joining other groups. I mean, it all gets
everyone
a little bit
talking at each other.
No one listening. No. There's about 15 different people all with those little mini rig things, just blasting out different stuff. The sound of balloons just the whole time. That, I mean, it all gets a bit Lord of the Flies after.
After a couple of days.
But that's a kind of there was definitely a thing, like when I was a kid, of people going to like Reading Festival, but just only going to the camping bit and not getting into like the bit with the music and just spending their whole time on the campsite.
I must be missing out on something here. Nothing there about that. But I'm sure it all happens.
Yeah,
isn't it, you
know? I mean, those are the ones where the friendships forever are made and then immediately forgotten about 3 days later.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. You just sort of wake up on that Monday morning like, I don't want to see any of
these
people
again. Time to go home.
I want to go back to reality. Then you also inevitably get the security chasing people around. That was a big thing. I imagine that you've got Noisley, people seem actually fairly well behaved.
Oh, they are well behaved. There's hardly any trouble at Noisley. There's just maybe more welfare incidents, I'd say, where people don't know their limits with things and freak out and just need to be looked after, not like headlocks and rugby tackled out of the site. They need to be looked after for a few hours and more welfare issues. There's few twisted ankles because it's obviously it's in a forest, basically. So there's a few things like that. But in terms of like security issues, now all the people are really friendly. The security are really good as well, so they deal with things in the right way. There's none of that sort of Reading type, there's none of that sort of.
I've been to I played at a festival which I guess will remain nameless. It was quite a long time ago. I'll tell you after.
All right.
But they'd obviously had some real problem with the fence.
Yeah.
That people were just sort of streaming over. And the security were just losing their minds and were just sort of like, right, well, let's just rugby tackle everyone and try and tear them out. And it was just going on for pretty much like, we were there for like 3 days.
This was a big festival, right?
Not gigantic. Oh, okay. Like it was, I would say it probably had less than 10,000 people out there.
Oh, wow. Okay.
But it was chaos.
Really?
And I mean, there must have been like, This is the thing. It's the same issue with security at clubs and stuff. Mm. There's I don't believe a security guard has any legal rights in the way a police officer does to manhandle people.
Sometimes I think they do though.
Yes. Yeah. Quite.
It's so very difficult finding a good security company.
Yeah, I bet.
Because they can often be the naughtiest. Some of them. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, yeah.
They need.
Yeah. they're behaving worse than the actual.
Yeah. Exactly.
Badly
so it's punters, difficult to find. A security company that have got that sort of presence, but also the people skills to go with it.
Yeah.
To deal with
what
things.
What did it used to say on Ray Flyers? Tight but polite security.
Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, jiu-jitsu, the violence is the last resort, isn't it?
Oh, well, it should be.
It should be.
But it can often not be.
Yeah, exactly.
But then it's, you know, let's take Brighton for an example. Mm. Like, if you go down, well, it's not called the Honey Club anymore, but back in the day, I think it's called Shoosh.
Oh, yeah. Shoosh, yeah.
Shoosh.
Yeah.
God knows why.
Yeah.
But I do remember a few incidents there back in the sort of mid-noughties where it's like, what's going on here? Are these like the security, like they actively, they just have arrived for a punch up? Like they're just straight up just challenging people to fights. Like they're throwing someone out and they're like, all right, well, you know, do you want to just do a fight?
I think that whole mentality in security companies and security people is kind of changing.
Definitely.
Now.
Yeah.
You know, there's different things they have to go through with councils and stuff, and I think the mentality of the sort of old school security meant that's changed a lot over the years, I think, but it's still there, and especially at a big festival they can get people get away with a lot of stuff if you're not careful.
Well, that's it. But then also with places like say the Honey Club or these more, you know,
commercial
places where you know you have some slightly more unsavoury types, shall we say,
that's a nice way of putting it, Will.
I don't know. Like, you know, I don't think I've ever seen a fight at the Volks.
No.
Maybe once, and I've been to that club more than I've been to any other club in the world.
Sure.
But, like, I've been to the Honey Club about twice and probably seen about five fights each time.
Exactly. So different sort of mindset.
Yeah, those security, they have to deal with much tougher problems. Yeah. Like, you know, you've got bouncers in the Volks and they're walking around drinking cups of tea. Like, I mean, the guy's called Mr. T, but nevertheless, he's drinking a cup of tea on the dance floor. It's, you know, there's a certain element, you know, it's a certain confidence in that, you know, it's really not going to kick
off. It's a friendly crowd,
Yeah. Mm. I imagine it's much more like that, Noisily.
It is very much so,
Next time I'm there, mate, I'm going to test those security boys. Maybe I'll take over the firm.
Yeah.
There's a book which I've been meaning to read for a while about the guy that ran One Nation.
Okay.
For a while.
Right.
And it's a sort of warts and all expose of that side of the club scene.
Yeah, that'll be an interesting read, I'm sure.
I bet it will. You hear some stories.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of fun happens at festivals, like, but you do get issues, like you say, with people overindulging and stuff.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people, like, for example, the Daily Mail, might like to think that it's much more of an issue than it actually is. There's been a few articles that I've seen shared around of late. One was about Boomtown.
Yeah.
And stuff, kind of trying to paint it in an extremely bad light.
Yeah.
I know Secret Garden were doing, I think they did a thing last year where they had a stall where you could come and test any drugs.
Yeah.
And they were saying that something like 75% of people who used it threw away their drugs after testing them.
Because they weren't what they said on the tin.
Who knows?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's obviously a slightly grey area.
Yeah, I mean, obviously you can't condone anybody doing anything illegal anywhere, of course.
It is going to happen. And I think it's probably a good idea. To make sure people are safe, basically.
Yeah.
you know. But I think it would only be trialled at bigger events, something like that.
Yeah.
You know, a smaller event like Noisley, it would just...
Yeah.
It's probably a lot of cost involved for a start.
Yeah, I think there's probably not enough people to go through the thing to actually make it worthwhile, yeah, maybe,
but
for setting
I mean,
it
I
up.
Think I think it's really good that it's being trialled at bigger events, and yeah. I think it can only be a good thing, really.
Yeah, I mean, there's...
And obviously the police, I think, are happy with it, and it's stopping people... dying.
Yeah, well, that's the point.
That's
isn't
the main
it?
Thing
yeah.
is that it's people's well-being is at the core of that.
Yeah,
thing.
I mean, ultimately, you're responsible for all these people that want to come and have a party and have
that's
a good
it.
Time.
It's a lot of stress and pressure as an event organizer because you do feel responsible for all of those people that are there in some way.
Yeah,
even though you minimize the risk and make sure everything's safe, people still. Will push those boundaries, their own boundaries, and get themselves into trouble.
Well, this is an interesting thing, actually. If you think about, say, like the glamping side of it, where some of the packages are expensive, like the
could go on holiday really abroad.
Yeah,
for
you pay £1,500 for a really amazing one, and I feel like if you're the sort of person that would do that, you're doing it as a either you're very rich or you're doing it as like, we're only going to go to one festival, but we're going to really do it properly and we're going to have the best time ever.
Yeah.
I feel like they might be the sort of people that might end up trying to push their limits too far. It's like the sort of the yearly version of the weekend warrior who work hard all week.
Yeah.
Now the weekends, I just absolutely lose my mind. Yeah. But like, you stretch that out over a year and it's like, right, well, we're going to go to, this such and such festival and, we're going to go in super hard. And
yeah. We have this amazing group of people called Cosmic Air,
right?
That are like a welfare group, and they're basically psychologists and a mixture of all different skill sets and stuff that basically will help people that are having a bad time.
Oh wow!
Yeah.
Okay.
So they and it's because for people, for example, people having a bad time, that have pushed their limits too much or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not really a medic. It's not really a first aid problem.
Right.
Like a broken leg is. And so we learned this over the years is that you need just a welfare team of people that will look after and give them a comfy place to sleep, give them a cup of tea, talk to them, calm them down.
Yeah.
So that's over the last 2 or 3 years we've had them at Noisley. It's been amazing. They've been amazing.
Really?
Yeah.
How many people do they have?
Oh, quite a few.
Yeah, really. Well, oh no, I was actually going to say.
I wasn't there. If that's what you're insinuating, Will.
I was actually saying, how many people do they have on hand?
Okay. A big team, probably like 20.
Okay.
But obviously they're probably doing shifts and stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Sure.
But yeah, Cosmic Air.
Right.
Really good group.
That's
of people.
Really interesting. I'd love to have a chat with them.
Yeah, any people that are putting on events or anything I would highly recommend them.
Okay, and so, how interesting.
Yeah.
I mean, I can just imagine what I would, if I was in such a situation, what I would like the person to be like. I'm sort of, I'd like them to be quite like my mum, but not too much like my mum.
But not like nagging. Yeah. And
not actually my mum, okay. I think. Like, because I feel like she'd just be very disappointed in me. But she wouldn't be angry, but she'd be, come on, you're
slight
a grown man.
Have you not learnt by now?
Yeah, God's sake. but someone is more like a kind dinner lady.
Yeah, exactly.
That's just there and just go, oh, didn't we get you a cup of tea, love?
Yeah, I think that's
yeah, that's it. Come on, it'll be all right. You're just a bit partied out, aren't you?
Exactly.
Yes, I am a little bit. I think
a lot of it is the fact that people, dehydration and not eating and all of those things.
Yeah, I think
too
also...
Too much drinking, not sort of pacing yourself.
And if you're in the sun
balanced
all day.
And in the sun.
Yeah.
So there's a mixture of all those things, not just,
Yeah. We've seen some hilarious sights in Brighton over the last couple of weeks. Like, there was that really hot spell, about a month ago or something, where people suddenly went, oh my God, it's going to be 24 degrees out there tomorrow. We'll just go on the beach at 9 o'clock in the morning and just start drinking. And then by about 6 o'clock, there are all these sort of deranged looking lobster people, like just sort of like creeping around the city. Like they're just... just like have no idea what's going on, like these pink zombies.
Yeah.
And it's like, no, you've
a little bit of sun and they're like,
come on,
mental.
Just keep it's when it was, because like a couple of days before that, I was bloody. I was smashing up a pallet and burning it in the front room in the fireplace to try and keep warm. Like, and then 2 days later, it's 24 degrees. People just like that switch. Like, oh, this is too exciting.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, people need to pace themselves.
Exactly.
I've learned a few lessons at festivals, particularly when it comes to DJing on the second night.
Yes, like, okay.
I did one at a Secret Garden party where I just stayed up the whole night. First night, rolled through, thought that would be fine. And got to DJing. Did a great show. At least I thought. Yeah. Some people seemed happy.
What few thousand people think?
Who knows? Who knows? And then I was having an interview backstage and just threw up everywhere.
Oh.
And I was like, yeah, sorry, guys. I think I'm going to go to bed now. But I've learned now. Gentle pacing, you know, make sure concentrate on a good performance.
Yeah.
You know, that is the reason that you are here.
Yeah.
Like, you're not you can be a punter after the performance.
Yeah,
but you know, behave yourself and you know, don't get a bad name for yourself.
Get booked again.
Exactly. Did I play the year after? I don't know. I'll have to ask Eddie. So have you got plans for, you know, is there more stuff you want to do with it? You say you don't want to, say, push it over, like, go beyond 5,000 or something.
Maybe we will in a few years go up to, let's say, 6 or 7. But yeah, it will always remain a sort of a boutique, more intimate, sort of independent festival.
Yeah.
To retain its sort of ethos and the sort of vibe that's at the festival.
You do hear a lot of complaints about stuff becoming overly sort of corporate and stuff.
Yeah.
A few years ago, people were making a lot of fuss about Best of All, like Topshop adverts or something everywhere. Yeah.
And it makes it difficult. Might be a lot easier if we just went out and got corporate sponsorship, but that's
probably
not
would.
That.
Maybe you should.
But that's not what it's about for
go
us.
Go and get like some banks to sponsor it or something
be good.
Like that. Yeah.
But the way that we're growing is... with the arts, performance, different micro stages, different areas.
Yeah.
Like, I don't want to give too much away because we'd like to have a surprise. But
so what have you had over the last couple of years for, like, non-musical stuff at the...
Oh, like amazing art installations.
Because that's a whole nother way to sort of get in on the festival being a DJ or an artist.
The best way for people listening is to just go and have a look at some of our the official promo videos from previous years, and you can see the level of art and production and performance. Tightrope walkers over the dance floor, big interactive performance stuff, a whole team for obviously decor and art, and a whole team for performance performers and all that sort of stuff. So that's it's a really big part of the festival. Also, in the last couple of years, we've developed a whole area called the mind, body, soul area.
Right.
So the more holistic side, talks, workshops, all of that kind of stuff. So more of a sort of a lifestyle rather than just banging party in the forest.
Yeah, sure.
The whole kind of picture, the whole package.
Yeah.
Where people can come and relax and unwind and...
Yeah.
Get spiritual, man.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Because stand-up comedy seems to have been a thing that some festivals have been including as well.
Oh, yeah. I think in the early years of Noisy that we had a little bit of that, but we had, like, underground cinema, you know, all different little smaller things like that. So there's not much more room on the site to have another big dance arena.
Yeah.
So we have three main arenas. One's the Noisy stage, focusing on techno, cutting-edge techno. The liquid stage, which is sort of progressive and psychedelic trance.
That's where the dreadlocks are.
That's where all the patchoulis, patchouli and dreadlocks and all that. But lovely crowd. And the treehouse stage, which is the one you played on, which is a bit more of the urban.
The bass
music and the drum and bass and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Glitch hop and neuro and all that kind of stuff. And everything in between, really.
Yeah.
And the leisure centre, we've got two sort of what we call micro stages, but they're not that small.
Mm.
But the leisure centre that's at Boomtown, that's more of the sort of jungle, that kind of edgy, amazing crowd, great production. And this year we've got a stage called the Parliament of Funk.
Yeah.
That's basically everything non-electronic, sort of like disco, funk, soul, all that kind of more eclectic stuff. A lot of female. We've got a whole female Sunday.
Right.
A group called Womb 2.
Womb 2.
They're basically pushing having more female DJs in the music industry.
And
all of that sort of stuff. Because it's a sort of slightly male-heavy lineup. This year we had a little bit of flack for that. So next year we're going to be pushing for a lot more female artists, but it's difficult. You've got to have
an equal pot to draw from, though. I can't imagine a reality whereby you're going, well, we're not going to book them because they're women. I mean, it's just no way. But there are less female DJs than there are male DJs. It's obviously growing.
Yeah,
enormously.
Exactly.
But it's difficult.
It's something that next year we're going to make a concerted effort to try and book more. Because, a little bit of flack for that this year, but it's difficult. Because doing
festival bookings is tough, and running a festival is tough, and then trying to...
You're not going to keep everyone happy.
You will never keep everyone happy all the time, but, it's, and you're booking people, presumably, on... how many people you think are going to be brought to the festival?
That definitely has to be a part of it. Will it equate to selling more tickets?
Yeah.
Will it equate to, for example, getting editorials and press interested?
Mm.
Obviously, not all of the acts are booked on that, but a percentage are.
Yeah.
To grow.
Yeah.
To move forward.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's. Let's just taking female DJs as an example. Mm. I think the numbers of female DJs have been growing rapidly, particularly over the last, let's say, 4 or 5 years.
Yeah, that's right.
But even if right now there were as many girls getting into producing and DJing as there were guys, it still takes a few years to build your name up and build your brand up. So it's not something that's going to happen overnight.
It's not.
But 10 years from now, I really think that as long as everyone's doing their best to make sure that the opportunity is there for everybody who wants to, everyone who builds their talent and shows off their talent and pushes themselves in the best possible way, has the opportunity to play at festivals and everything, then everything will even out, I think.
Yeah.
To the extent that, people want to.
100% agree with you. And you can be my spokesperson for equal opportunities if you want, Will.
Don't worry, it'll be all right. Give us a couple of years.
Yeah, get on Twitter for me, will you? Yeah,
sure. Great. Before I see the Twitter lynch mobs coming after me already.
No.
Yeah.
That's what it's like.
Yeah. I'll get accused of being genreist or something we've only booked drum and bass. It's a drum and bass stage. No, you need more techno. It won't work. You can't put minimal techno and then drum and bass and everything. Sorry, you need 50-50.
Yeah.
Dear me.
Yeah.
So you've got a few secretive plans for the future.
Yeah, for this year, you mean, or?
Oh, yeah. Are there any little nuggets you want to let people in on for this year?
We're building this whole new area that's going to be like a hidden fortress type thing that's going to be
a new
element to the festival. I'm not going to give any more away than that.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a lot more new art installations.
Yeah.
That will be really good, sort of high-end, sort of bespoke art installations. Some of them just purely made for the event itself.
Mm-hmm.
And always new elements of decor and stuff like that. And yeah, that's it really.
Yeah.
The best thing to do is go and check the website for all the stuff that's going on.
Are you playing this year?
Yeah, I'm not. I think last year we played Atomic Drop and our new techno project, Audio Anonymous.
Mm-hmm.
This year, I think we're just going to focus on the Audio Anonymous, the techno set.
Nice.
Yeah. So looking forward to that.
Yeah. I've heard rumours that the techno is good.
Oh, thank you very much. Yeah. Ken and I have been focused on that the last couple of years, really. So you know what it's like when you're producing and writing stuff.
Mm.
We want to go out and play that out, really.
Yeah.
Rather than.
Yeah, yeah.
The stuff that we wrote a few years ago.
Yeah,
that,
of course.
That was great back then, but things change, don't they? Taste change and...
Yeah. Why don't you take that big old modular you've just got out with you?
Oh, yeah, that might be good fun, right?
God, can you imagine? I did a live set at Secret Garden a few years back, the one where it just poured with rain every day.
Oh, yeah.
It was quite harrowing, actually. Mm. But, yeah, I did a live Rain City Riot set there with, like, modular and all the electron
bits. Oh, nice. Yeah.
And it was actually really good. I think it was the only time that I've done it where it's, like, it really all worked. You know, when you've got a setup that's sort of that intricate with everything, there's always something can...
A bit nerve-wracking. A little bit nerve-wracking.
Actually, I was saying earlier, we were talking off air about doing stand-up comedy and how it's just the most nerve-wracking thing ever. That is more nerve-wracking than stand-up comedy because there's so many moving parts that could go wrong. And like one like MIDI clock goes out of sync somewhere and you're just like... Or like you nudge the pitch on the oscillator or something on the modular and you've got to retune it.
Yeah, of course.
So like I had to have like my phone with one of those tuning things in and then stop everything and then plug an input into that and tune the... Oh, man, it's...
Did it go well though?
Yeah, it went really, really well. Nice. People really liked it. And
You've still got all your modular kit?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, nice.
I'm just about to set up all the live stuff in the... You've got a new studio in London.
Oh, great, yeah.
So, yeah, all the electron bits and then most things run through Ableton for a little extra bits of tweaking, bung a few loops over the top.
Yeah.
So you could have drums from the Analog 4.
Oh, nice.
Then have the modular and then also maybe a couple of other little bits. I've started running the virus. I've got a little virus running over it.
Lush, man, yeah.
Man, the sounds out of that thing are just...
Bonkers, isn't
nothing.
It?
It's... Yeah. When it behaves, sometimes because it has that VST interface, which is amazing.
Yeah,
when it works.
Yeah, I'd like to hear it.
Yeah, no, I'll send you some bits.
Send me some bits, dude.
And you can send me some techno.
I will do after this is over.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Right, James. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you for having me, Will. It's been a pleasure.
Mate, absolute pleasure. And I'll see you very soon.
Bye.
Cheers. Bye.